Now Elijah the Tishbite from Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, "As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, whom I serve, there will be neither dew nor rain in the next few years except at my word." Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, "Leave here, turn eastward, and hide in the Kereth ravine east of Jordan. You will drink from the brook, and I have ordered the ravens to feed you there." So Elijah did what the Lord told him to do. He went to the Kereth ravine east of the Jordan and stayed there. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. Soon, sometime later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. And so beginning in verse 8. Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, "Go at once to Zarephath in Sidon and stay there. I have commanded a widow in that place to supply you with food." So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow who was there gathering sticks, he called to her and asked, "Would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink?" As she was going to get it, he called, "And bring me, please, a piece of bread. As surely as the Lord your God lives," she replied, "I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said, but first make a small cake of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me, and then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says, 'The jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord gives rain on the land.'" She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and for her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. The word of the God, of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I suggested to you last week that the stories about Elijah kind of play out like a cosmic boxing match of sorts. Remember that? In one corner is the storm god, Lord Baal, and in the other corner is the Lord Almighty, the great God of Israel. And last Sunday, we witnessed the first round in this cosmic duel. Elijah the prophet told Ahab the king that there was going to be a severe drought. No moisture at all. Not even dew would fall to the ground from the sky. But Elijah wasn't giving King Ahab a weather report. He was giving proof to the king that the God of Israel and not Baal provided rain and thus sustained all life. Well, as the narrative continues, somewhere out there in the cosmos, you'll hear a bell chime, and everyone is gathering once again around that ring, because you and I, friends, are about to witness round two. Listen, and you will hear. Have you never been to a boxing match? Do you know how long it took me to find this chart? I don't know. They don't say play ball. I don't know what they say. Raise your fist! Here we go. So we pick up in this story when the drought that Elijah predicted is weighing very heavy on the land. Resources are being compromised. And that little spring that Elijah was drinking from has dried up. So God sends Elijah to Zarephath, which is a village of Sidon. It's ironic that Elijah ends up here because you see the Sidonians worshiped Baal, you know, this storm god who is supposed to make it rain. And yet even in Zarephath, the earth was dry and the ground was hard, like maybe Baal hadn't done anything to relieve the suffering of his people. So God sent Elijah into Baal's territory. And God told Elijah to hold out there, to stay with a widow woman who lived in the region, because Israel's God was going to provide God's prophet with food and nourishment in the land of Sidon's God. Well, so maybe it's not all that ironic that Elijah ended up there. Maybe it is just part of God's ingenious plan, right? Elijah traveled to Zarephath, and he went to the home of this woman who worshipped Baal. She was supposed to feed Elijah and keep him alive, but when he found her, she had no food. "As surely as your God lives," she told him, "I have nothing." She swore by Elijah's God, because at that point she wasn't sure if her God was still up and about anymore. She had very little oil in her jug. The flour supply that she kept was almost gone. She had enough ingredients to bake one last cake of bread, kind of like a tortilla. And she intended to bake that cake of bread for herself and her son, and then they were going to eat it, and then they were going to starve to death, because apparently her God could not save them. Elijah walked into a very desperate situation. But he was sent into that situation by the Lord God Almighty. So he came with an offer of hope. He told this woman to mix up what oil and flour she had, and then they would all eat. Even though she only had enough ingredients for one loaf, God promised that she could make two. So she trusted the promise of Elijah's God. And she made bread for the prophet. Then she made more for herself and for her son. With the little bit that she had, she fed all of them that day. And then she fed them the next day, and the next day, and the day after that. Every day there was flour enough. Every day there was oil enough. Every day there was bread enough. Bread for Elijah, and bread for the woman, and bread for the woman's son. What the widow's fraudulent God couldn't do, the God of Israel promised and then delivered. And the woman had bread for life. I have another favorite Bible verse to add to my growing list. It's Proverbs 30, 8 through 9. You heard it just a few moments ago. Proverbs chapter 30, verses 8 through 9 says this: "O Lord, give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Otherwise, I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord anyway? Or I may become poor and then steal in order to provide for myself and so dishonor the name of my God. Give us this day our daily bread. Isn't that how Jesus taught us to pray? God gave the widow of Zarephath sustenance for each day. She didn't have more than she needed because maybe then she might disown God. She didn't have less than she needed either, so she wasn't forced to look elsewhere for provision. Every day, she had just enough for her tiny community. She had exactly what was needed to keep Elijah and herself and her son alive. She had just enough to sustain them and just enough to keep them dependent on the Lord. It's important to note, I think, that Elijah went to a widow and to her fatherless child. They would have been among that culture's most needful and dependent people. And yet God used them as a source of great blessing. And note also that this woman's supply of oil and of flour continued to grow precisely because she shared what she had. She could praise Elijah's God for gifting her with what she needed, and she could trust in his God even as she shared that gift, that God would continue to provide. The thing that keeps coming back to me as I study these Elijah stories is that we want to be very careful not to read them with inflated piety. And by that I mean, we don't want to accuse other people of worshiping false gods like it's something that we ourselves have never done before. The text calls us to examine where we turn for bread. What or who do we count on to fill us? This narrative asks in a very straightforward way who we depend on for life. We are surrounded by fraudulent gods that promise everything we desire. And we have all at one time or another submitted to their ploy for worship, yes. But the Lord of Israel, the God of Jesus Christ, offers a daily provision that sustains our soul each day, every day. And as we learn to express our trust in that provision, we are then able to benefit other people with the presence of God through Jesus Christ, which is our bread for life. God is this life-giving sustenance offered to us without measure. God through Christ is the life force that never runs dry. In fact, the more we share this holy food, the more there is to give. Even when we are soulfully impoverished, when we feel alone like we never have before, when we are grieved by great loss, when we feel fearful of life and of love and of commitment, when we are unbelieving of what might God do for us, when we think we barely have enough to keep ourselves alive, if we offer this divine resource to others, we discover there is always, always more than enough for everyone. I think it is in light of that good news that we intend to put these shoes on the plane. And as we support Edwin and Tatum in their trip to Haiti, we share this bread of life. The shoes they take are going to go with the blessing from Trinity United Methodist Church, and the feet they cover will be touched by our love for God through Christ Jesus our Lord. So at this time, as a response to the word, I would like to invite Edwin and Tatum to come forward so that we can bless them and send them in love so that they can share our blessing and our love to the children, with the children in need. So if you will please come.